privilege to be with you, for the honor to be with you. We, as Pastor said, we do travel the world preaching the gospel. Lord, only gave us one commissioner. The other day, you know, I felt a little bit blue, and I said, Lord, are we still on the right track after 14 years doing this kind of work now? Before that, we've been in the gospel ministry for about 14 years. And the Lord gave me that one scripture in Corinthians where he says, you have been called, I've called you to preach the gospel. And that's what we do. We preach the gospel. We love to preach about revival. We love to stir people. We love to make people uncomfortable and to let people think about where they are in their walk with Jesus Christ. We are thankful, as Tina said, for your love, your friendship, your support, your prayers. We cherish them and we pray and we thank you that God is blessing this church. It's full this morning and it's wonderful. It's so early in the year to start like this is wonderful. I see that you did pay attention and that you did love my previous message 1 year ago, because the previous message was go, remember? So I don't know if I can put that there, maybe awake today. And I'm just joking, but God bless you as we listen to the Word of God. Open your heart. Just let the Holy Spirit do things. Don't listen to my tenses, because English is my second language, okay? And I'm not good enough in comms either. So just listen to the Spirit. Forget about things. Let God work in our hearts. Amen. Because family, it's desperately needed that the church rise up and become powerful in the gospel of Jesus Christ. There is no other answer but in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
I think it's in Ezekiel 24 where we read that all systems fail.
Yeah.
The priests, the prophets, the people. There's one more P, can't remember. Anybody remember? No. Everything failed. And God said, I'm looking for a man or a woman who can stand in the gap. And I pray that God will do some awakening in us today. That we will be able to say, yes, Lord, here I am. I will stand in the gap. I will shine for Jesus Christ. I will be unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And God be glorified. Amen. So just thinking, Pastor Edgar said, you must love, during your vision statement, you must love one another as Christ loved you. Oh, and then I thought about the statement, you know, but the Lord said, do unto others as you want others to do unto you. So this little guy came back from Sunday school. Mark said, what did you learn? He said, oh, we learned about this verse. Mark said, which verse? He says, this verse, do unto others as others do unto you. Now that's not what it is all about, eh? We're not going to do unto others as others do unto us. Unless, of course, they love us, then we will love them back. But even if they don't like us, if they don't love us, we still got to love them. Because Jesus says, love your enemies. Sometimes the word is not like it to read it. But your enemies. Anyway, our scripture will come from the book of the book of Joel. Joel. Chapter 3, and also chapter 1. When I was a young boy in grade 8, I went to a hostel school, boarding school, lived in a hostel. 5 years later, I met Ina from that school. So we in item this year. This year we are in item for 50 years. Thank you. And, but I was a city boy from Johannesburg, Melville, and I went to this agricultural high school. And oh my goodness, I mean agriculture, farming, Buddha. Ooh. And Buddha want to get up early in the morning. So very early in the morning, every morning at 5. This teacher would walk down the passage, knocking with his cane on the door. Wake up! It's time to wake up! It's already 5 a.m. in the morning! And if you sleep a little bit late, you notice that a little bit more, you will come in with a cane and eat from the blanket, but it goes through, it's sore, you know. And I don't like those words. Wake up! We even traveling all over the world, and once we had a little cell phone like this, a very basic model. Only you could only make calls to see this and this, but it also had an alarm. And sometimes, as you know, Pastor Edgar flying up and down and flying all over the show, Pastor Edgar, we have to set this watch, this clock, and then it will ring in the morning, one ring, and then it says, it's time to wake up, it's 4 a.m. It's time to wake up, and I wanted to throw the thing against the wall. So a wake-up call, I don't think is nice for me. For my wife, it's definitely not easy. When I say wake up off before 7, then I'm in trouble. Or we have to go somewhere, or something important must have happened. But in Joel chapter 3, there's a spiritual call to wake up, which is applicable to us today, as it was those days. So we're just going to look at some of these things. And give you a bit of a background. This was about 2,400 years ago, and the situation in Israel was not uncommon to what is happening today, not just here in our country, but all over the world. There were natural disasters in chapter 1, verse 4. What the chewing locust left, the swarming locust has eaten. Natural disasters were there. There was a morality problem. Great immorality. In verse 5 we read, awake you drunkards and weep. Same thing. There was a political problem. For a nation has come up against my land, strong and without number. There will always be politics. There was also a constant reminder of the Lord that we have today. Be ready because Jesus is coming. Chapter 2 verse 1. Blow the trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming, for it is at hand. And then there's also a call to repent. Unfortunately, I think we do not hear enough about the call to repent these days in our churches. Maybe I see some of you say amen. Now therefore, in verse 12 says the Lord, chapter 2 verse 12, says the Lord, turn to me with all your heart, fast with fasting, weeping, and with mourning. So rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness. Did you know one of the great things about God is his loving kindness? That we can fall so far away from him, but if we return through repentance, he waits for us with open arms, embracing us once again. It's an amazing thing about our religion. The love of God. There's one scripture that says Israel was on the edge of falling into hell. But then they repented and God embraced them again. Isn't our God is so wonderful. And then in chapter 2, 28, there's also a promise of power. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. The sons and their daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. I'm starting to dream dreams. I never dreamed before. I don't know why. It's a reason. Now the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. Now I'm one of those very basic Christians. I believe the Bible as it says. It says there's nothing new under the sun. I believe there's nothing new under the sun. So the situation is much the same in many ways. The occasion suits us. Today, the prophecies of Joel, the prophecies of all the prophets are as valid today as they will always be. So, we're going to Joel chapter 3, and from 9:16, we're not going to read the whole portion, because it's a bit of a lengthy portion. We're going to use some scriptures, and I'm going to just show you some things from that scripture. There's first of all, a very urgent call to the nation to wake up. And that's why I started with this wake up story. How many of you like to wake up, being waked up too early in the morning? How many of you like to be waked up just any time of the day when you sleep? No, we don't like it. But here's a very relevant call. Wake up. And it's in verse 9. Proclaim this among the nations. Prepare for war. Wake up the mighty men. Let the men of war draw near. Let them come up. In many churches, we find many sleepers. Yeah? Even the cream of the apostles slipped during the most critical hour in history. When Jesus had that battle with Father God, that diligent prayer that made him to sweat blood, the disciples were sleeping. You were coming, but then they said again. The hour is late. And I pray that spirit all over planet Earth will ring out a wake-up call to the church. That the church will realize it's more than just me, myself, and I.
Come on, yeah.
To be a Christian means that you've been called to be a blessing. It's a prime function. Well, praise God for our salvation. But the purpose is to be a blessing, to go and make disciples. It's not just for the evangelists. It's for each one of us. In many different forms, we're not going to look at that. There are many ways to bring Christ, people to Christ. Andrew was not an evangelist, but he brought people, always he brought people to somebody, he brought people to Jesus. He's just bringing them. Some of them here, and most of them here, are by invitation. That's how he first came to this church. And that is a wonderful ministry. Ministry of invitation, right? And so as I said, there are many, many sleepers in the church. And you know what a sleeper is? That thing they put on the railway line in the old days. Now these days they use cement blocks. And so there's an advert from a furniture company and said, we need 300 sleepers, urgently. We got a big order. And the pastor phoned them up and said, you can have my whole church. The hour is late. The moment, and at any moment it can be that Christ can return to planet Earth. Are we ready? Are we awake to experience that great and awesome moment? Because, you know, I read in the Bible that suddenly it will happen.
Yeah.
And if it happens suddenly and I'm spiritually not awake, I'm going to miss it. Because I'm going to wake up first. And then, oh, suddenly, where's all the people gone?
Amen.
So we have to be awake, spiritually. And that's an important point, I believe, to go in. For this time of the year, beginning of the year, the hour is late and we have a responsibility. Church, we have a massive responsibility to make known the good news of Jesus Christ to the nations. Come on, church.
Yes.
To tell them about the life of abundance we have in Christ. And the victory we have over situations that come our way.
Yeah.
We are different men. Say your neighbor, I'm different. Tell them why. Because I'm a Christian. All things have passed away. Everything became new. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We have a responsibility to be victorious in our battles. And even if we lose it physically, we must have victory spiritually. The spirit must wait. It must sit down under us. Now, it's so easy to become, what's the word, sad and worried. Sister testified here about she worried, not the Bible says, people say, don't worry, why do you worry? Actually, the Bible says don't worry, Matthew 6. Don't worry, if you worry, you die. And if you don't worry, also die, you know the story. So why? Why? Okay. To tell them about this peace in the storm.
Yeah.
Come on, church. We're a different nation. We're a different culture. We're different citizens. Our citizenship is in heaven. That's what Philippians 2 tells us. No more citizens of this earth. We got a South African passport, though, yeah. But our citizenship is in heaven. And wonderful things to tell the world, to shine the light, to be an example, because the world is anxiously waiting for the revelation of the sons and daughters of God. Waiting anxiously to see something.
something different with hope. And we have that mighty hope in us, but the mighty man and the mighty woman are sleeping. Who are these people, the mighty men and the mighty woman? Let me tell you, they are not celebrities. Amen.
Amen.
They are not political leaders. Amen.
Amen.
They are not brave army soldiers. Right? They are not money tycoons. But they are men and women who once were dead in their sins and trespasses. They are now alive. They live by the love and by the grace of God. And they should live like that. But those that were dead in sin, but they have the fire of God within them. They were convicted of sin. And this is important. By the Holy Spirit, there was a conviction once in their heart of the sin and their shortcomings, and they cried out in tears to God for forgiveness. Forgive me, God. And God did a marvelous thing in their lives. He touched them after they confessed their sin. And after they repented of their sin, He touched them and He set them free. Amen. Every church has them. Many of them.
Hallelujah.
He set them free by the blood shed on the cross. On that cross, on the hill called Calvary, they've been made righteous. They've been made holy. Set aside for special duty in the army of the Lord. They understand the meaning of righteousness. They understand the meaning of holiness. Just on Wednesday we did a Bible study on holiness. Holiness is not to have two wings and a halo. Holiness means to be set apart by God for service.
Amen.
Amen. To be usable. Like the instruments in the tabernacle were set apart. They were made holy. To be served for use in the tabernacle, to serve, to be used in the kingdom of God. And that's why we are called saints. Amen. But the saints are sleeping. I'm Saint Johannes. And that's Saint Catalina. If you believe and you went through the process I just told you, you are Saint Edgar, Saint Arnold. People sowing chaos, and we have the light. Did you know that darkness is extremely afraid of the light? We can close these windows, switch off these lights, and you just put on your cell phone. No, light suddenly disappears, and the more light there is, the more less darkness there will be. It's logical, but it means an army of God that's not sleeping. You see, the night will come when no man can walk. And it's not that night yet. Let's not make it to be that night now. It is our time to shine. It is our time to make a difference now. Even if they hate us. Hello? Because it's going to happen. Some reason the beautifulest religion in the world, the one of love, peace and joy, is the one that everyone wants to destroy.
Yeah.
Amazing. Why everybody wants peace? It's a religion of true peace. In me you have peace, and our King of Kings is the peacemaker. Isaiah 6. Amen. And so the other enemy is sin. They will not rest until they overcome. They will not rest until they overcome. Because the Holy Spirit will work in their hearts. And they will remind them of things and me that needs to be straightened out. And we say, yes, Lord, by your grace and by your help and by your power, we will become victorious over sin. These mighty men sleeping they have Christ in them. And they are in Christ. They're not afraid to die. Because they took up their cross many times, daily, according to the word of God. And they walked up to Calvary and they died many times. of their sin. So there's no more fear of death. The great second death to come, we're not afraid of it. Who of you are afraid of death? You should not be, because that's promotion into glory. And it's so amazing. Everybody wants to go to this glory place. And the other day I asked the judge, who wants to go to this glorious place? And everybody put up their hand and I said, who wants to go now? And nobody wanted to go now. It's amazing we are. Why are we afraid? I'm looking forward. It will be a great day. I'll meet my son. I'll meet my mom, my pa. Oh, my brother, my sisters. I'll meet them there one day. Amen. Many other loved ones. We'll see each other. Are we looking forward to that? So I'm ready to go. I will not hasten it, that I promise you. But if the Lord comes now, I will say glory, hallelujah. Amen. Because I'm saved and ready, I'm not afraid of death. And I hope you are not. Because if you are afraid of death, you better come to Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Amen. Because he takes away all fear and all things like that. They're not ashamed of the true gospel, but they're sleeping, man. They are not attracted by the charismaniacs and stuff, or soldiers of doom, and they call sin by their name. They're not compromising. They're not willing to do these things, but they're sleeping, man. They're too quiet. Judge, we are too quiet in the world. A lot of evil things become legal, and we are just too quiet, man. We have to shine and take stand. Amen.
Amen.
Now, there are many such mighty men and women in the churches, but they come comfortable. They suffer of affluenza. You know affluenza? Affluent people have too much of that. Okay? They suffer of material prosperity, of comfort. Old stale traditions have lulled them to sleep. Wake up the mighty men. And the woman who are in slumberland, or is it la la land, I don't know. But just wake them up, they are sleeping. You know, we talk in many countries and there are places I think people only sleep when they're in church. We do Bible study. And before, they're still introducing me when I get up there. So it wasn't my fault. I did not talk them to sleep or anything. I did not bore them. I didn't even have a chance to bore them. In the beginning, I was silently offended. But then later I said to the man, sir, wake up your brother. Wake him up. Then I said to him, listen, next time I come to this church, I'm bringing a big water pistol. I will wake you up. Don't sleep, you are me. Amen. Don't sleep on me. We're talking about heavenly stuff that can change your life. Wake up the mighty man and the mighty woman. Awake, awake, we shout. Do not wake me up, they shout back. Why do you want to wake me up? Oh, there's a fight to win, there's a fight to be fought. There's a battle to be won. There's work to be done, man. It's not just the Christianity for 1 hour on a Sunday morning.
Yeah.
It's a lifestyle.
Yeah.
A lifestyle of action, of readiness, of alertness, of ability, and the willingness, of course, to make a nuisance of myself for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Give Him the glory now. About faster, about bigger, about better, about higher, about lower. That's what they dream about. They're sleeping in their affluence. Don't rock my boat. It's so nice here in the harbor. A boat in the harbor goes nowhere. Amen. You've got to face the storms. And the storms will be. And then, oh, sleeping in sin. But pastor, don't stir me up. You are out of popular political correctness, because what I do, everybody do in the whole liberal world is satisfied with that. No, wake up. There's a word of God, and there's only one word of God, and that word of God is absolute or it's obsolete.
Amen.
Amen. Who should wake who? Well, you should wake me up, first of all. You think I'm sleeping? You wake me up. Amen. And that's why I'm here this morning. Just trying to be an instrument, praying that I am, to stir up this church more. You know, you guys are really skipping, and the music really is going, isn't it? And it's an awakening. It's an alert church, but we must be spiritually alert. Because our flesh fight is not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and municipalities and all other things. In the name of Jesus Christ. I don't think we're that good. It's just a joke, okay? Amen. This instruction to wake up is accompanied by a challenge. Change what you are doing. Amen. Verse 10, beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. The definition of insanity is simply this. If you keep on doing what you have been doing, you will keep on getting what you have been getting. That's the definition of insanity. We all want change, but we don't change. If we want to go on, we need to change. You're going to trust God more. You're going to work towards that dream. People build sandcastles, sand castles, and then they start painting them. But when the wind comes, it just blows away. Nothing ever happened. Follow your dream, the dream that God has put into your heart.
Yes.
And change. Things are sometimes need to be changed. So if you are sleeping spiritually, wake up. That's the message. Simple, isn't that rocket science? If you are tarrying, start moving. Because Israelites said, well, you've heard it, I think. They had a good time there. Very good time there in the desert at the mountain. I think everything was just nice. And they become close, very comfortable. And God said to them, you have tarried long enough at this mountain.
Yeah.
Time to move on. And Christianity is always about moving. Tell you about that just now. And if you're sinning and you're calling sin, my dear friend, simply this, stop it.
Yeah.
That's not rocket science.
Yeah.
That's not rocket science. Read Colossians 1, no, Colossians 3 from verse 1 onwards. And you will see that he actually says, stop it. Just stop it. Is it so difficult? But Pastor, you don't understand. My grandfather was an Irishman. That's why I got this temper. Always angry. Stop it. You've been at the cross, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yes, Pastor. Then stop it. Pastor, you don't understand. I do. Just stop it. Tell your neighbor, just stop it. Amen. Suffer or whatever. Because we are new creatures. It's so biblical. Just stop it. You can't tarry at this mountain of nonsense forever. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You still like me?
Yes.
You don't have to like me, you're going to love me. Many want to become active for the Lord. They do not know how. Take a drastic step. Take a drastic step. Remember, when you come against the devil, you can't fight in the old way with a big powder puff or something like that. You've got to come against him with the word of God. He needs some change. Jesus did not do anything but said, thus saith the word of God, when he was confronted by the devil. So take a drastic step. Beat the plowshares into swords. Sword is the word of God. And I cannot underline this enough. The sword of the word of God is absolute. Although there are many translations, the basic message, the basic conditions, and the basic promises are all the same. They've never changed. Because God holds his hand upon his word. And if we try to change the word of God, we're creating an idol. Because this is the word of God. And not what my worldview wants me to have. My education, where I come from, my childhood days, my friends, everything plays a role in my mind, my teachers, professors, whatever. And from all these things that's accumulated in my mind, I have a worldview.
And that's how I understand the world. And I read the Bible and see it's not exactly how I understand the world. The Bible is strong. Pastor God is a God of love. He loves just anybody. He loves the sinners, but he expects them to change.
Yeah.
Amen. He loves the sinners, but he expects them to change. So, beat the plowshare into a sword. And use that sword. Thus saith the Lord. Therefore, we've got to know how to use the sword. Amen. You've got to know the word. There are many things in that Bible that I don't understand. There are things that I think, oh, this is a contradiction. Then, how can this pixel, nanopixel minded brain outwit God of creation? Shame on you. Because God is always right. The moment we start doubting, it's over. First thing that happens, fall asleep. And eventually dying, that's it. The word is absolute. We believe it or we don't.
Yeah.
We try and change. The thing is, when there are contradictions, when there are things that I don't understand or I don't agree, what do? We go on our knees.
Yeah.
And we say, Lord, that doesn't make sense to me. I know you're right. Will you not give me revelation?
Yeah.
Open the eyes of my understanding.
Yeah.
That I can see what you want of me, what you require of me. But don't touch God's word.
Yeah.
Amen. There are two scriptures, Old and New Testament. One at the very end of Revelation, where he gives warning for those who tamper with the word of God. It's dangerous. Amen. Don't do it. So, I said to you that the Bible full of changes. Just look at the life of Jesus, how he changed. Came from heaven to earth to show the way change. From the earth to the cross. Pain to pain. I'm singing that. I'm stopping with you. Let's go again. Yeah, that's the beginning. He came from heaven to earth. From the earth to the cross, change. From the end to pray. From the cross to the grave, change. From the grave to the sky, change. Amen.
Amen.
God used change. Look at the life of Jesus. Came from heaven to earth into mother's womb. Virgin's womb changed into a young teacher at 13 years old. He taught the professors and the scribes and the elders in the temple. Changing into a carpenter because he was taught to be a carpenter. Changing from a carpenter into the anointed Son of God when the Holy Spirit came upon him. And from there he traveled all through Jerusalem, up and down. He did not sit and wait for people to come to him like a fat guru waiting for people to come. No, he was there moving, finally to the cross, finally to the grave, then the resurrection, and then coming again. Amen. He's coming again. Maranatha.
Hallelujah.
So there's always movement in the Christian life. Change what you're doing is another thing. This instruction has a twofold command. It says say it. I am strong. Say it. I am strong. Verse 10. I'm strong. Let the weak say I am strong. Amen. Our strength as Christian warriors is not in our muscles, in our whatever. It is in Christ. When we're weak, we're strong. Amen. Did I ever show you that little show about being weak? Come and stand quickly, maybe for one. Come and stand quickly. We wake up the mighty. We wake up the mighty warriors. He said, "When I'm weak,
I'm strong."
Poor.
I am rich.
In
am a prince.
I am a prince.
In Christ Jesus.
In Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Stop the if onlys in your life.
Yeah.
If only, Pastor, if only I had more faith. Then I said, oh, ye of no faith. That's why when we left Pastor in ministry, they sang, what? Okay. If only I was not married. If only I will work for you. If only I have no children. Or if only they are out of the house. The real pastor said to me, I will work for the Lord. If only I didn't have these three dogs. He's a pastor, but he wanted to travel like us. If only we didn't have these three dogs. And they ugly little things like me. If only I had a better education. If only I had another job. If only I get a 10% decrease, I will die. That's a lie. Don't say it because you're not going to do it. If only I had more money. If only I could sing like Rebecca. If only I had a better mother-in-law. If is an illusion. Amen. So get rid of those if and do it.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Let me tell you, if you want to become a doctor, don't say, if only I had more brains. Because you would not have had that desire if God did not already equip you to become what you want to be. Time, church, that we know who we are in Christ. Amen. We've been redeemed. Say with me. Redeemed.
Reconciled.
We've been resurrected.
Sanctified.
Justified.
United.
Blessed. And empowered.
Hallelujah.
That's who we are. That's why we're different. Paul cannot say these same things. The second command. In that instruction, put in the sickle, go.
Yes.
Yeah. Verse 14, there are multitudes and multitudes in the valley of decision. Family in the valley of decision. Around us, they haven't made up their mind yet. Just in 2018 be a time that we really challenge them.
Yeah.
So listen, we can talk to you long enough nicely. Now you're like wood in a fire. I'm going to pull you out by force. Repent! Okay. Friends, neighbors, colleagues, nations. Do you know God more than 360 times? The second blessing, the first blessing is our salvation. Well, there are many blessings for us, but there's always after a blessing or even before there's a condition. And that's to be a blessing. And more than 360 times said, it's to do with the nations. Bless the nations. Go out to the nations. Even Acts 1 verse 8. Even all the four great commissions, when we read them in the four Gospels, for the nations, for the nations, for the nations. God loves the nations. That's why we are saved. Amen. Because we are also nations. Amen. Be obedient to the great commission. Be evangelistic. Oh, Pastor, I'm not an evangelist. Be evangelistic. If we have a testimony, we can be a witness. Hello. You don't have to give him a theology, screw what's in theology. You just tell him, as I have been, let me tell you quickly, I've been so bad, I don't even want to talk about it. Because people use a testimony, they tell a long story how bad they were. And I've had so many women, I've had so many dogs, and I can do that, I can do that. And it keeps on and on and on and back. Where's the glory? I've been bad. I mean, a terrible thing. You ask my wife. But then Jesus came into my life.
Amen.
Amen. And since now Jesus is in my life, it's a changed situation. I even the children ministry, but I love them now. That's a testimony. Amen. Then he said, would you like to experience that change as well? Yeah, I can see you've changed. Tell me how you did that. Oh, sit down. I'm going to tell you about Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So go, be a witness, be an evangelist. Do you know what's an evangelist? Evangelist is a nobody who tells everybody about somebody who can change anybody. Amen. People tell people about Jesus Christ. That's all we have to do. Now, like, open your mouth wide, says the Bible, and I will fill it. Oh, but I don't have a theological course behind me. Open your mouth wide. I will say it, says the Holy Spirit. You will be a witness for Him. Amen. Get trained to be a witness then, if need be. It's essential to make this become a true disciple. A true disciple can share the gospel. Hello?
Amen.
Amen. Can share the gospel. Hand out tracts. There's such a power in handing out tracts. We think it's old fashioned. I'm telling you, it's still working. Because people just pick up a track and their lives can change.
Yes.
Amen. There are many ways to do it. Lastly, what I see and what I want to ask a question, and this is really important. Who issued these statements? Who said wake up? Who gave instruction? Who gave the challenge to change? Who gave the two great commands? Put in the sickle. Say I am strong. It's the Lord in verse 16. The Lord also will roar from Zion and utter His voice from Jerusalem. The heavens and the earth will shake. Who is this Lord? Who is this King of God and of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. He is the King of glory. Amen. He was. From the beginning He was. Born of the Virgin. Turned water into wine. Calmed the seas. Healed the lepers. Walked on water. That's Him who's shouting, issuing this great challenge to us to wake up. He is the Son of God. He's God Himself. He's the Savior of the sinner. And He's the healer of the sick. He's the deliverer of the oppressed and comforter of the broken. He is the Good Shepherd. He's the light of the world. He's the brilliant morning star. He's the King of kings and He's the Lord of lords. He's the first, the last, and the everlasting. He's the Alpha and Omega. He was and He is to come. He's born to the star. He says, wake up. Years ago, we had an outreach in Botswana, Lubansi. Who are you from Botswana? Anybody? And we had this outreach, and in the mornings, we went to the schools, hospitals, and so on. They allowed us to go to some school. There was a school with 1,000 kids, primary school. And the principal said to me, Pastor Juan, you only got 10 minutes. I said, no. Yes, Pastor, sorry, we got work to do. I said to the children, okay, I only got 10 minutes. I want to tell you about somebody. Somebody who did marvelous things. And every time I say something, you say, wow. So I said, okay, this person, he turned water into wine.
Wow.
He was not excited as you are. One or two. And then I said, you know what? This person even walked on water.
Wow.
This people person healed the lepers. Wow. I said, he healed all kinds of disease. Wow. He took two loaves of bread and five fish all the way around and he distributed them and thousands, 5,000 people got fed and there were 12 buses of food left over. Wow, they shouted. And then I tell them, this person, he died on the cross to take away our sins. And there was no wow. I said, but don't be sad, because on the third day after they buried him, on the third day he rose triumphantly from the grave. Wow! I said, who of you want to meet this person? All the hands went up and all the knees bowed that morning on that doormat. And they committed their lives to Jesus in prayer. Short and sweet about Jesus Christ. He's the Savior. All we have to do is exalt Him. People will say, wow, I need Him in my life. Now, my dear friend, the call is wake up. Spurgeon. Look, haven't
deep investigation into your spirit. And this challenge is for me, my wife. Are we ready to face 2018 as a true believer? Or are we just one of the crowd? Are we just a statistic as a Christian? Or are we ready to go and make a difference? Even if it's a pain to others. Just keep to the word. Keep to the authority of the Holy Spirit. Submit to the authority of the Holy Spirit. God is sovereign. And His word will not return void. Just go. Go. Alert. Ready for action. All the time ready for action. Remember when I was in community with us? When I was young Christian, still young, but very young. When I got saved, you ask Kina. You walk in the street, I see somebody. Are you saved, sir? Same with her. Sometimes embarrassed her because people were supposed to be saved, and I ask them, are you saved? And then they get angry, especially some of my family. Don't be ashamed. Every time that you ask somebody about Jesus in his life, it's a seed that you grow. You might not respond that moment, but he'll go home. Somebody came to my wife at that time and challenged her. Said, I see your husband is saved, but are you really sure about your saving? Your salvation. She was angry. She was. Because how can this woman ask this of me? And then God, the Holy Spirit, worked in her. And even then, she submitted again to Christ Jesus. You see, we have to be extremely sure. Make sure your family know that you are saved. Because the day will come, you might just die before then. You're going to be buried. And then everybody says, Pastor, where is my husband? I can't say he's in heaven because he looked like he came from hell. So what do they say? Nothing is impossible with God. Make sure your family knows. Knows Jesus? Knows Jesus. Amen. Come and stand. On in close, I just want to remind you how he roars. He roars. He does not whisper. He roars. That's the name of the scripture. Like a lion of Judah. Amen. With a voice like a trumpet. He like the sound of many waters. And it will fill many with fear. Those who know him will find in him a strength and a shelter. What does he roar? Joel 3:16, the last few verses of this portion that we looked at. I will be a shelter for my people and the strength of my children. The mountain shall drip with new wine. The hills shall flow with milk, and all the brooks of Judah shall be flooded with water. A fountain shall flow from the house of the Lord. There's always a promise after an instruction or after a promise prophecy. Amen. After the conditions, wake up, do this, do that. We went through all of them. Here's the promise. I'm your Lord. I'm your God. I will bless you. Father, we thank you that you change not. But your word is forever true. We thank you, Lord, that we can learn from your word, that we can be challenged by your word. And I thank you, Lord, that this morning we could just consider a few of the things that you instruct your children to do. Pray, Lord, that we will humble ourselves and obey. Obey, Lord, believing that your word is true, to do what your word requires of us. Become fiery, alert, ready for action, changing whatever needs to be changed. And all for the glory of your name. And all of us say, Amen. Amen. Now, just a question before we retire. Well, we got to go get the plane back to Rudderburg. All right. And are you saved, sir, ma'am? Are you absolutely sure? How many never met me before? How many haven't been here? How many new people who do not know me? Just put up your hands high. It's quite a number. Pastor, can I use 5 minutes? Can I check him out? You see, I want you, everybody, we're going to check, you know, sometimes we fall asleep. We backslide. I'm going to look you in your eyes. And I'm going to ask you a question, are you saved?
Amen.
Salvation is holistic. It covers every area of life. In other words, when I ask you, are you saved? It means, have you been saved from anger, lust, corruption, cheating, lying, stealing? This is endless. You can just read Romans, the last verse of chapter 1, last two verses. This is endlessness. Have you been saved? So I'm not going to repeat that every time, but that's what the word entails. Have, in other words, has Jesus forgiven your sin? Are you victorious over sin? And when you fall into sin, do you run to Him and ask for forgiveness and go on with Him? Are you saved? I want you to look me in my eyes, because the eyes are the window of the soul, did you know? So when you look me in the eye, you say, yes, Brother Juan, I'm saved. But you're not. I will see. I promise I will keep quiet. I will not split on you. But the problem is God also knows.
Yeah.
Amen. So just quickly, I will come around, start over there, and ask you to look me in my eye and be honest and say, are you saved, sir? 100% by you know. You know what? Today is the day of the Lord. Guys, when you come out, come stand in front. We go, sir, are you saved? Oh, sir. You are?
What?
Pastor. No, Pastor. That's it. Today is the day of the Lord. Today is special. Come, brothers, come, sir. Have you now? Have you saved, man?
Are you still saved? I must ask you. Rocco, are you still saved?
I'm working in my
country. Wow, you're going to start 2018, wonderful day! Please come. And if you know you're going to come out, just go to the front. Please. Just go. Just go. Stand on stage, there's no more. Sure, guys?